So the Riemann zeta function is 1 over 1 to the s plus 1 over 2 to the s plus 1 over 3 to the s plus etc. This function is a type of infinite series. Does that mean it approaches infinity? Not necessarily. It means we're adding an infinite number of terms. Since the domain is that the value of s must be greater than 1, we only getting a finite number in that region. Otherwise, the result is infinity. For example, by substituting 2 in the function, we get a result that is pi square over 6, which is weird, right? I mean, how is this thing related to circle anyway? And surprisingly, every even number fed to this function involve pi as a result. Zeta of 4, for example, is equal to pi to the power of 4 over 90. And similarly, 6, 8, and 10, they all involve pi as a result. But that is not the case with odd numbers. Their result proved to be irrational, and not much is known. And by substituting infinity in the function, we get 1. Then we have the harmonic series, that is when s is equal to 1, resulting log infinity. And here we have Euler product. This thing is equal to the zeta function and has the same domain as the zeta function. However, there are some differences between them. Euler product consists of an infinite product of prime numbers. So, if we insert any value in this thing such as 2, we get the same result as the one with the zeta function, pi square over 6. Now let's talk about complex coordinate system. On the left we have the xy plane, while on the right we have the complex plane. So what are the differences between them? Let's first start with the xy plane. It involves only real numbers, and they can be inserted in two dimensions. While for the complex plane, it has complex numbers, real and imaginary numbers, and has one dimension for real numbers and another dimension for imaginary numbers. So what does that mean? It means, for example, if we feed the function 2x with values such as 2 and 3 in both planes, unlike the xy plane, this point can only perform horizontally in the complex plane since they are real numbers. Rising a complex number to a real number can be represented in the complex plane, such that it will keep circulating with a fixed radius as we change the value of the power. For example, 4 to the power of 1 plus xi circulate around the origin with a radius of 4. The real part of the power controls the radius of the circulation, while the imaginary part controls the movement of the point around the origin. If we compare 4 with 8, we can see that 0.8 has double the speed of that in 4. If we take out the real part of 4 and compare it with the original 4, only the radius changes from 4 to 1. While if we replace 4 with a quarter, the only difference is the direction. Meaning 4 will move counterclockwise while quarter will move clockwise. And if we plug a negative number such as minus 2, the point will start circulating from point minus 2 rather than point 2. And here we have Euler identity stating that having e with the power of variable imaginary number is equal to cosine that variable plus I times sine that variable. So in the complex plane, the cosine represents the real part while the sine represents the imaginary. As an example, if we replace the variable x with pi over 2, the cosine factor will be 0, while the sine factor will be 1. Since it multiplied with I, we get I as a result, plotting it somewhere over here. Any real number to the power of a complex number can be written in the form of sine and cosine. 4 to the power of 3i, for example, can be transformed to e. And from that, changing it to sine and cosine form can be obtained, approximately equal to this. So that point will be somewhere over here. Another example is 1 over 5 power half plus 6i. A few differences are there from the previous example, but the main difference is the real part of the exponent, which is why the radius is smaller of that of the previous one. Now we have most of the tools we need to calculate the zeros of the Riemann zeta function ourselves. But before that, we need to know about the analytic continuation of the zeta function that is used to extend the domain of the function from s is greater than 1 to s is greater than 0. So here we have the zeta function. First, we multiply the left and the right side with 2 over 2 to the power of s. Then we subtract the zeta function from this result for both sides. Then by simplifying, we get the eta function on the right side while the left side have the zeta multiplied by that factor. If you don't know about the eta function, it is similar to the zeta function, only its signs alternate between pluses and minuses and has a domain of s is greater than 0, while the zeta function has pluses signs with a domain of s is greater than 1. And here you have it. We successfully extended the domain of the zeta function to s is greater than 0, and so it seems. So for example, if we substitute s with 2, we get pi square over 6, the same result as the previous example, which is great, right? Basically, what I just said was nonsense. This extension is partially wrong. We did a mistake with the calculations, that's why we have a different result than the one we should be getting. So let's talk with numbers rather than words, right? Let's go back to this step and observe the right side of the first and the second lines. Now let's have the very same lines with the value of s substituted with 1. And for now, let's only take 8 terms of the function. You can see that there are some terms which have been ignored. Like in our example, negative 2 over 10, negative 2 over 12, negative 2 over 14, and negative 2 over 16. However, these terms will clearly approach 0 if we increase the number of terms taken. I mean, if we calculate this series with a huge number of terms, then the value of each of these ignored terms will be close to 0, which is why they can be ignored, right? That's not true. If we increase the number of terms of this sum, we will have more ignored terms as we go on. For example, if we take 8 terms of the function, we will have 4 ignored terms. While if we take 100 terms of the function, 50 terms will be ignored, and so on. This implies that getting smaller ignored terms does not necessarily mean their sum will approach 0, because we will have more ignored terms as well. So it's not a one-sided issue. In fact, there are some conditions that allow the sum to approach 0 as we take on more terms of the function. So for now, let's refer the sum of the ignored terms as x. So think of x as not only these 4 terms, but all ignored terms as the function goes to infinity. This table represents what x will approach in different ranges of the zeta function, while we bear in mind that we take an infinite number of terms of the function. So when s is greater than 1, x will approach 0, which is why we getting similar results before and after the analytic continuation. While when s is equal to 1, the value of x will approach negative log 2. And finally, if s is less than 1, x will approach negative infinity. So what does that mean? It means that after the analytic continuation, the domain of this function must be s is greater than 1 rather than s is greater than 0. It also means if we substitute s with 1 in the zeta function after the analytic continuation, we get 0 over 0. Since numbers to the power of I keep circulating in the complex plane, implying that the 0 over 0 result will be repeated infinitely many times with a fixed interval. Basically, this result is when the value of 1 over 2 to the power of xi is real, and this happens periodically as shown. So does that mean there are no zeros of the zeta function? Of course there are zeros. The only difference is that the connection between the zeta function and the eta function have different domain than the one it had before. Since the eta function is the function responsible for the zeros of the zeta function, we can only use it to calculate the zero ourselves. So how do we calculate the zeros of the zeta function? Okay, assuming the domain of this function is s is greater than 0, as you can see this function have two brackets. So if the result of the product of these two brackets is 0, it means that one of these brackets will result 0 or both of them, right? Let's start with the left bracket since it is easier to deal with. I also need to mention that we need a value of s that will result 0 in the zeta function. For example, s is equal to half plus 14.1i, the first 0 of the zeta function. If the left bracket was responsible for the zeros of the zeta function, by substituting this value we must get a 0 as well. However, this is not the case. We get this result, which is not a 0, which implies that the left bracket is unneeded, which also implies that the right bracket will result 0, so no need to test it. Now let's take only the right bracket and replace s with the same value, half plus 14i. In the previous slides, we already learned how to turn such values to sine and cosine form. So all terms are converted to sine and cosine. Cosine represent real values while sine represent imaginary values. Only for the first term, which is 1, will be added to the real values only, since 1 to the power of almost any number is 1. We can also represent such function as a graph in the xy plane by replacing the number 14.1i with variable x. In that case, each of the real and imaginary values will have different graphs, which is something close to this. In the graph shown, the red line represents real values while the blue represents imaginary. So, if we want to graph the function with variable x and identify its zeros, they will be represented as an intersection of the real and imaginary lines with line y equals 0, as shown on the graph. We can easily graph real and imaginary lines separately using xy coordinate system to see the intersection of the zeros of the eta function. This intersection will get more accurate as we take in more terms. And that's how we calculate a zero of the zeta function. So the Riemann zeta function consists of different modified functions. We have the original zeta and Euler product. Both of these two versions of zeta have domain of s is greater than 1. Then we have zeta after the analytic continuation. Zeta equal to this factor multiplied by the eta function, which have a domain of s is greater than 0. Then we have what called the functional equation. Using this formula, any result of the zeta function will be reflected in point half. For example, if we have 5, it will be reflected to minus 4. And if we have minus 2 plus 2i, after the reflection it will be 3 plus 2i. Since we already extended the domain of the zeta function to s is greater than 0, By plugging inputs of the extension to the functional equation, we can get the sum of the zeta function with any number of s except for s is equal to 1. I'm sure that many of you heard about the negative 1 over 12 result. Well, it's actually a result of the functional equation. We take the sum when s is equal to 2, which is pi square over 6, feed it to the functional equation, and the result is minus 1 over 12. Does it mean that the sum of all natural numbers is equal to minus 1 over 12?